Good morning, everyone, again. Welcome to the second day of the advanced Bonsai Workshop. And today will be a bit more informal than yesterday, in the sense that we will go through the visual editor of Bonsai, and I will try to do it in a more kind of demo way. So I will open up the editor a lot, and we will go through together into what it allows you to do. So again, I want to recall that Bonsai is really this visual programming language layer on top of Rx, okay? Plus the packages, so a set of features that we have been building up over time that provide a lot of functionality that is already built into the environment. So you don't have to kind of, because all of the abstractions we talked about yesterday are very useful. But as any abstraction, it is only as useful as its implementation, right? So you need also a lot of functionality that is already done so that you can kind of hack away and combine it to do what you want. Again, I want to remind you, press on this to be reactive, ask questions, because there's, again, a lot to cover. This time, not so much, in a way, it's conceptual in the way we have designed the editor and the language. But there's a lot of little details embedded in the editor that we've been building up over time. And things may not be entirely clear, so again, please interrupt me right away if something is not obvious. So we're going into the second day, Bonsai Toolboxes and Visual Editor. So we'll go into the two last factors in the Bonsai equation, so the visual programming language and the packages. Okay, that's where we are. So as I was saying, so Bonsai is really this visual programming layer on top of Rx. And I say this quite explicitly because actually, so this is the kind of visual representation that when you open up Bonsai and you start building your workflow, you see these kinds of nodes that have names and that are kind of linked together. But they're really just a program in Rx. And I say this quite literally because actually Bonsai compiles directly to Rx. So when that's the first thing to realize, is when you are laying out these elements graphically, you're actually writing a program. And it's actually no different. There's no interpretation layer. So there's no, in the end, when your program is running, it's compiled actually down to native code because .NET compiles to native code. So there's really no difference. You could be writing your program by hand and it wouldn't make a difference. That's the first thing to realize. Later, I will comment that actually this also gives you power, very interesting, powerful options, because you can actually take control of the way that this code is generated, and we can discuss later the possibilities that this opens up, which are quite interesting. But for now, you can just see this as you can interpret the Bonsai workflows in the way that the operators connect with each other. But you can also think of them in terms of the marble diagrams that we discussed yesterday. So there's kind of a color code that comes with these nodes that kind of tries to give you a first glance of what the node is doing. So we chose, nodes in violet are sources. So these are sources of data, is where the processing can really start by acquiring the data from these sources. In this case, the camera, and the key down is a stroke in the keyboard. And then in white, you have transforms. So these are nodes that basically take data from some observable stream and bulk transform it to another stream of data, but without changing the flow of the data. So this is just a projection, like a select, which we discussed yesterday. So it's just a function that maps one input value to another input value. But it doesn't drop any values, for example, and it doesn't change the rhythm at which the values are being produced. So it doesn't do, it's just really a function. Then you have it here in dark gray, you have sinks, which are the side effects we also discussed yesterday. So there's a saving to a file, or showing the visualization, sending information to the internet or whatever. And then in blue, you have combinators, which actually, so combinators, I mentioned it briefly yesterday, they are the reactive operators, which you can see in their website, the list. In fact, conceptually, every node is a combinator. So actually, a node is only blue if it's not anything else. But you can think that actually every node is a combinator, which was something that initially was not entirely true, but now it is. So from starting from Bonsai 2.2, everything is a combinator, and actually this enables even more powerful options of how to put things together. Anyway, so to illustrate, these are the three visualizations you can see of this program. So this is the graphical version, and here in the bottom you have the equivalent kind of reactive little program. Okay, so you have this function, the camera, you select grayscale images from the camera. So this is a projection that projects color images to grayscale. Then you sample those images on keydown. So whenever a keydown event happens, you take one picture from the data stream and then you do save image. That'll be the equivalent program that you would write if you didn't want to. Yeah, if you'd be directly on Visual Studio, for example. And here is just the marble diagram representing this. So how do you construct these graphical workflows? So we built over time this visual editor, which provides a number of features. So it's divided into three main parts. So on the left, you have the toolbox, where all the nodes that Bonsai knows about are displayed. And this is modular, as you've seen yesterday. So you can extend it. You can extend it via Visual Studio. And the only thing you need to do is to kind of register with Bonsai where your packages and your nodes will be added to this toolbox as well. You can search for a, so you can either play around here with a hierarchy, or you can search in this little search bar over here. You can just type the name of the node and it will kind of list kind of the nodes that match, kind of starts to help you to find things more quickly. So you can program relatively fast in the editor. Then you have the workflow view per se, where the nodes are laid out graphically. So one decision we made early on was to have the layout be generated automatically. And this is because, I'm terrible at drawing and it's doing design, so it's I really don't want to worry about it, but I still wanted the workflows to be readable somehow. So the idea here is that the way the structure is laid out, it always turns out this will always be a feed-forward graph. So, and specifically, there's one constraint that I'll tell you right away that it may seem like a limitation, but it actually isn't if you plug things in the proper way, which is you can't have any cycles in this graph. Okay, so the idea is that it's really a workflow. So it's what is called a DAG, a directed as acyclic graph. So there are no cycles in the graph. And this imposes a natural order, because you always start with the sources, and you always end up, it doesn't necessarily need to be synced, but it stops at the end. But in the middle, you can kind of branch things, and we will discuss what this branching really means in terms of Rx. You can branch, kind of merge these flows together, and you can have many flows in parallel. And Bonsai tries its best to kind of lay this out neatly for you. There are still some kinks to be sorted out in this automatic layout, but hopefully this will get better with time. And finally, you have here on the right the properties window. So this is essentially parameters that are available to each node for configuration. So whenever you select, whenever you click on a node, or if you walk on the workflow with your keyboard, the currently highlighted node, or in fact, the currently highlighted set of nodes, because you can actually do multiple selections, and the properties here on the grid will be the common intersection of all the properties of the selection. Okay, so let's say, for example, you're picking multiple file outputs, or let's say some node that has the same parameter. If you select multiple of them, you'll be able to set the property for all of them. Things like this.
Is that like a keyboard shortcut to select all?
Yeah, Control A. Yeah, should select hopefully select all. Yeah. And then there's these little windows, and this is also something that I found very powerful. And in fact, these two, the properties window I was just discussing, and these windows, the visualizers that I will discuss now, are actually one of the main reasons why I find this visual environment interesting for making Rx. And this is one question that comes naturally, is that, okay, if we have Rx and it's a powerful programming language, then why do we really need Bonsai? We just open up Visual Studio and kind of do everything there, because it's equivalent, right? But there is one thing that I personally could not do very easily in Visual Studio, which is the online parameterization of the workflow. And this is something that if you do signal processing or image processing, it becomes very important right away, is that sometimes you need to tweak things. And it's very useful if you can see the effects right away. So there's some kind of visualization of what's going on in the data. And then I can tweak the parameters, and online I see the effect. And this is really, I don't know, over time, with many experience of doing these kinds of applications, I've come to realize that it's actually quite useful to have these features. And so the properties allow you to edit in runtime the parameters, and then you have these visualizers, which are really just ways to inspect or see the data that is going through each of the nodes. So when the way you use them is you double click on each node, and depending on the data type, Bonsai will know hopefully how to represent that data type graphically. And you can also extend this, so it's also modular in the sense that you can build, if you have your own custom data types, you can also write visualizers, so pieces of code that tell Bonsai how to represent graphically that data type. And then you can kind of use it everywhere. And before we open up the editor, I'll just talk about one more thing. There's lots to talk about here, but by the way, questions about this? Yeah.
How do you call the program? Is it called?
You mean the
you call it a workflow?
Layout? Yeah, it's a debate actually, and probably there's I will be blamed for this because conceptually in the editor I call it workflow, although technically it probably should be called a data flow. But this is actually a debate that I have. It's an interesting conceptual debate to have. So a workflow is more like a sequence of steps that you do in some kind of work or computation, like a work pipeline, like assembling a car. So you have a workflow for assembling a car, which is you kind of take the pieces and you put them together. And you can see this as a workflow in the sense of the building process. So the way they work, the way the final reactive program is built. So it is a workflow in the sense that things are built in the order of the flow, from left to right. But you can also see it as a data flow from the processing point of view. A data flow is more like you have a this programming paradigm where you see nodes as being independent actors or being independent kind of processors. And the only thing they do is share data. They are connected via wires and they kind of share data between them. And you could also see Bonsai as kind of as a data flow kind of programming language, because it's specifying the sharing of data between operators that can be independent. So there's been these two ways to describe it. But mostly, I think, informally, The convergence has been to call it a workflow, but it's an ongoing interesting debate. You call it workflows.
Is it nested?
It can be nested, yes. We will discuss it.
So the need to know is a workflow as well?
Yeah. Yeah, it can be nested, yeah. We will discuss nesting extensively. I will show it today, a graphical nesting, and then tomorrow we'll go in more detail. There's functional nestings you can do as well, because one kind of nesting you can do is just for graphical organizations. So you can just kind of group a set of nodes so that graphically it's a bit cleaner to read. But another thing you can do is some kinds of nestings can have functional meaning the workflow that is specified inside can be executed in a specific way depending on the nesting. But this will, let's for now leave it at that, and tomorrow we'll go into more detail of what this nesting, functional nesting means. Any more questions? Okay. So the important thing is, as we saw a bit yesterday, but we didn't see this screen yet, but I'll show it in a minute. So this is, Bonsai can be extended by installing new packages, and specifically not just any custom package, but NuGet packages. So NuGet is the official package manager for .NET, for the .NET kind of community. And it's kind of like for those of you who are Linux users, you know apt-get or the various package managers that come with the environments. Microsoft has decided to embrace this kind of concept for its own development community, and it has quite literally exploded. So there's now since NuGet came online, there's now billions of packages. In this and covering everything, not just Bonsai, but literally every area of programming you can imagine. Yeah, you can find stuff there. And the decision we made when we looked into ways to make Bonsai modular was very naturally to just use NuGet, because it's kind of an open protocol, and they have an API that you can use to kind of download and install the packages, so it is quite an easy choice. But this also means that you can in Bonsai kind of install not only Bonsai packages, you can actually install any NuGet package. So I'll show you some ways in which you can just download a package from the NuGet to do something, and then you can use it inside Bonsai using the scripting features that you'll see later. So it's quite a powerful little system. Of course, you can also install your own. So NuGet exists online in a gallery. You can upload packages there. It's public. It's open. You can also just install your own custom packages from the file systems. So you can have a folder like somewhere with some packages, and then you can point Bonsai to that folder, and then you can install packages from the folder. This is included in an online tutorial in the Bonsai website, but I'll show it here as well. And maybe now would actually be a good. So I just realized. So I was trying to. Here. So Microsoft actually pulled a fast one on me, because I wanted to show you very quickly how to turn the projects we did yesterday into a NuGet package, okay? Which actually the project template that you used, so when you create a new Bonsai package, it already includes a file that is in the middle of the template called this NuSpec file, okay? Where you can kind of this NuSpec stands for, NuGet specification, NuGet packet specification. And the idea is that you can fill in here metadata related to the NuGet package, okay? And then you can build a NuGet, a package from the project just by using this specification and the project definition. And it used to be, until this version of Visual Studio, so 2015 cannot do this, unfortunately, that you required only one click. If you have any version, maybe I think that computer has 2012, I think, you can try. But on any version of Visual Studio other than 2015, you would be able to right-click here, and there would be an option here called Enable NuGet Package Restore. You just click there, and it would generate automatically. Unfortunately, they removed this feature. I just confirmed that it's gone, so I will have to think about a way to make this easy again. But if you have a previous version, like 2013 or 2012, it will be there. But and also, I will update. I will think about this and update the template in some way to make this possible as well. So it's not a problem. But anyway, it's annoying for today. So sorry, I cannot show you. But it's literally, if you're still curious, you can also go to the. So the NuGet has a kind of a website with extensive documentation, so you can also read all about how to create and publish a package in the NuGet website, and it's exactly the same procedure. So the Bonsai packages are just NuGet packages, so everything that they say applies to Bonsai. Okay. So another goal, so last thing before we open up the editor, is just another goal for today, is to go through the packages that are already done in Bonsai. And this list is a small sample, actually, and it's growing quite fast. And this is just the main kind of processing packages. So you have the DSP, or digital signal processing packages, with kind of like the basic operations you can do continuous time series like filters or just basic mathematical operations. Then you can you have the vision package, which is where the image processing and computer vision operators are stored. These are mainly, both of these are based on the OpenCV computer vision library. So they're you'll see that the names of the functions and everything is quite similar. Then you have some kind of input and output packages, like audio is just to give you access to microphones and to save out wave files to sound files to disk and things like this. I started with audio because actually it's a good first step to start in audio to then go to, for example, electrophysiology. It's basically the same. It's exactly the same time scale and data layout, so it's quite similar. Even the same operations you want to do on audio is the same ones you later will want to do on physiology. Then you have Arduino, which is I have here. I brought one with me that we will set up later to see how Bonsai can get some things moving. Then you have some communication packages like OSC, this Open Sound Control. This is just, we'll discuss it. It's a way to, it's one of the ways, because now there are starting to be more ways, to have Bonsai communicate with external processes and external devices that, for example, are on the Wi-Fi or on the network. We chose OSC to start with because it's a very simple protocol. And actually, there are many people. This comes from the music scene, this electronic music scene community. So people who do like DJing and VJing, and they have like their own custom MIDI keyboards, and they kind of want to tweak effects online as they go. This protocol is very popular with them, and that's the reason why, if you look, for example, on the mobile scene, you will find many, many apps that actually broadcast your phone as an OSC server, so you can, as OSC server, so you can have access to the phone sensors for Bonsai if you download one of these apps and you kind of then catch it on Bonsai. But we'll play around with this a little bit. You have input packages, many other sources and sinks. Here on the table today, we have like an example, a selection of hardware that is already integrated in Bonsai. So everything that is on top of this table somehow can be run and used in Bonsai. You also have basic features of scripting. So you can, we started with Python because it's actually, when we started, it's a very well-known language for scripting, specifically. And there's a version of Python that runs in .NET called Iron Python that makes it very easy for people to just get started and write with simple routines. I will show you how to write these routines, even though now you have the ability to also do this in C#. But sometimes it's useful to just, I don't know, just write quickly something. Scripting eventually will also be allowed to be done in C#, but this is for the future. And then more recently, you have also access to computer graphics. So you can actually specify shaders, and you can kind of control the parameters of the shaders online. More on this later. Okay, so I think it's time now to just open up the interface. So let's start. So here's one side. Okay. And so the way this works, so you see the workflow, the toolboxes on the left. You can just write. I tend to, after you know the nodes, I tend to just write them here because it's just faster. So you can just, there's multiple ways to load a node. You can just write the name, enter, or you can search it over here and kind of right click, create source, or you can drag it. Any of these options are possible. And so now that we've been through Rx, you can see this, you should always see the nodes of Bonsai. Every single node is an observable sequence. Okay, so now what happens when you play the Bonsai workflow is really, there's a subscribe. Okay, so play is also equal to subscribe. You're subscribing to the sequence that in this case is defined by the camera source. And now Bonsai is running. Tells it at the top. Nothing happened because, well, we didn't say that anything should happen, but you can always visualize kind of what's going on by double-clicking on the node. Okay, so in this case, this is the camera. Please, I'll switch camera actually to this one. My table, so I'm going to the properties, kind of changing the parameters. So index in this case tells me which camera I'm using. So this is the little camera I have here. So the visualizer is just, in this case, is a visualization for images. So anytime you have an image, you can visualize it like that. These visualizers, they come with their own little features. They are sometimes a bit hidden. So for example, one feature you can do in the image visualizer, it opens up first a small window, but if you want to see the image at its full resolution, you can just double click on the window, and we'll expand the size of the window to be the size of the image. Another thing you can do that is useful, and you'll see later, is we can, if you right-click on the visualizer, also things usually happen. So in this case, it opens up a little kind of information bar where it tells you, as you hover over the image, it tells you what the position you are in the image and what the value of the pixel is for that position of the cursor. And this can be sometimes useful also for calibration, because if you want to calibrate, let's say, a threshold or something, as we'll see later, you can kind of check with a cursor what the range of values is. It's just a convenience. But this is just to say, in general, this applies to every visualizer. So there is usually these little tricks. You can try like right-clicking things, double-clicking on things. Maybe something happens. So it's in Bonsai, it pays off to right-click on things. It's a general rule of thumb. So for example, if I right-click on the node, a huge menu shows up, okay? With lots of things. This is actually an important menu to go through because it tells you a couple of things. So it tells you first the output of the node, and we'll go through the data types, what they mean. And you can kind of inspect through the, many of the types are kind of compound data types, so you can kind of go through and see what's inside the data type. We'll talk about externalized property in a moment. You have here this option of showing the visualizer, okay? And it actually lists which visualizers are available to use. So for example, I don't need to use the image visualizer. It's the one by default. The node specifies that it's that one by default. You can actually change it. So if I go here, here's the visualizer. If I change to the text visualizer, now I get a textual representation of the image. Another thing you can do now with actually this text, since I've opened it, is you can turn it into kind of a scrolling. So if you pull down like that, then this turns into a scrolling buffer. Actually, this is, it may not be the best way to see this, but for example, if you put a mouse, so I'm going to add here kind of a mouse move. So this is another source. It's just, again, a data stream. Okay, and let's take the, let's take just the mouse, actually. So this by default just shows you the mouse position, okay? But if you scroll like that, now it becomes like a, and the size of the scrolling is actually the size of the window, right? So if I put here, it shows, it scrolls three values. If you put it down, it scrolls many values. That's the idea. For example, another visualizer is, so if I was showing you here, you could inspect kind of the data type that comes in. In this case of the mouse is a point where the cursor is. You can also kind of select, this is kind of a shorthand. If you just want to pick parts of the data, you can here kind of, if you go inside the type and you kind of click on one of the inner properties, in this case the X, then Bonsai will insert a transform that selects that particular attribute of the data type. And then once you have that, then it stands on its own. So this is now an int. The output of this guy is an int. Since int is a primitive type, there's no further expansion. It's just an int. But now the visualizer is different. So the default visualizer for numbers is kind of like this little time series plot. You can still change it even online to a text visualizer, kind of expand it. So there's these little options that the idea is to make things easy to kind of work with. This was the for me, is again to emphasize, this is the main advantage I see in using Bonsai over, for example, coding this in Visual Studio, because here in there you have to kind of code, kind of play, then stop, change something, then start again, and it's a different feel. Anyway, so this, again, continuing, then you have these little options. You can see, the editors will see also in a little bit. You can, yeah, question?
The frequency rates of either the mouse and the camera are set where?
Yeah, so that's the important thing. So this is a very important point. The frequency of acquisition is completely specified by the data sources. So this is, we're in the observable world, so in the reactive world. So the producers of data kind of specify the rate at which the data goes through. So, for example, in the case of the mouse, there's actually not even any sampling in the sense that this is handled by the operating system, and there are interrupts that are handled when you move the mouse. And actually, it's these events that are generated when, in this case, the mouse moves. So, whenever you move the mouse, you will generate events at some maximum rate, but it comes like that. So it's
so if it's stopped, there's no...
Yeah, there's no events if you stop. So it doesn't keep... You can actually see this. So when I move... So if I keep my mouse still, then you can change to the time series. So the mouse is moving, but if I hold it, it doesn't continue on the same value, right? You could also use the mouse as... in a sampling mode, we'll go at that later. If you wanted to have like a fixed frequency of polling the mouse, you could also do that. So, but let's talk about that a bit later. But for now, you can think of this as there's an asynchronous data stream that you don't necessarily need to know the frequency. Of course, you do. Sometimes you can set it on the parameters of the source. But the idea is that the data source is responsible for setting the pace at which notifications are dispatched. Okay. So anything else? Yeah, you can. We'll go into this as well. Then you have the basic operations, steps, copy, paste, deletes. You can actually, yeah, this is again also important. You can kind of undo and redo kind of arbitrarily. In here, Control Z, Control Y. Yeah.
So just for an example, if I want now to project an image that depends on the value of the AX of the model,
change the
image.
Show an image
that changes the. Value.
The, so you say the mouse changing some value in the image. Is that it? Is it about that? So I have an example. We can actually go straight there. You can jump ahead. You can. So I put the slides up in no particular order because I these sort of just dynamic as we go along. So what you ask about is the. Idea of changing properties online, for example. So let's say one thing you can do in Bonsai, and maybe it's a good time to talk about this, it's fine. You can take properties that are specified as parameters of that node, and you can externalize them, is the term we use, into their own nodes. Okay? So what this means is that the externalized property, which is represented in orange, becomes a sink, a side effect, where when you feed a value to the node, it will actually write on that property. So effectively, this gives you a window to kind of change, tweak parameters dynamically online. So in this case, for example, I take a camera, I threshold the image, and then I can, this threshold has a value, and I can kind of change that value dynamically with the mouse X position, okay? So if we do this on our, already have the X, so I just, again, add the camera and the threshold, the image. So again, this is just a transform. So you see there's a threshold value over here. So if I just run this, just to show you, so this is a thresholded version of the image. This is an OpenCV operation. The image is in color, so the threshold is applied to each color channel independently. And this is the value of the threshold. So pixels above the threshold will have their maximum value, below will have zero. And then you can kind of tweak kind of the parameters here. And we'll discuss these editors. But this is in the property grid. But you could also, as we were hinting, if you right-click on the node, you can externalize properties of this node. Specifically, you can externalize the threshold value, for example. And now you get a little node over here that represents that threshold property. And now if I just plug the X into that threshold value, and now essentially I've coupled both together, and now I can kind of, as I move my mouse, change the threshold property, right? And the powerful thing here is it could be anything, right? So it doesn't need to be the mouse, it could be some kind of sensor, and you know, for some reason, you can kind of see the effect immediately. Once you do this, yeah.
Question?
Yes.
Is it automatically scaled to the values that your mouse input can have?
No. So it's completely, yeah.
So you see,
when my mouse is over here, the threshold may make no sense.
Yeah.
But maybe it does if the image values were scaled to some values. But it does, there's no assumptions, which is the most powerful way to do it, but also is a bit more work. But you can,
yeah.
I'll show you how to scale values with ranges. But anyway, yeah, that's so this is the first thing. Yeah, so this is it. And you can kind of do it with almost all properties, as long as they allow writing to, you can externalize them. Of course, when you externalize them, they become read-only. So you can't really change them in the editor anymore.
You didn't really say what is a property as far as the programming goes.
Yeah, well, actually, we went through it a little bit yesterday. When we looked at this first source, this little parameter we put in the source code here. So yeah, it's good to recap. But
so
it's basic.
That equals a property. I just, in terms of sometimes
notation
terminology.
Yeah.
of the external thing isn't always completely clear how
okay.
it maps on. So there's no properties per se.
Well, property. Well, they are in the sense that well, they exist in.
There's no term. It's like there's no term property. So that's it maps to what value.
Ah, sorry. Yes, it wasn't clear probably the first.
Does everything
yeah.
that is value get?
Yeah. No. Specifically,
property,
so a property is a C sharp concept that basically represents an encapsulation of a value in an object, and specifically, what defines a property is a getter function and a setter function. So it's basically functions that either read the state of some value in the object, or which is a getter. Or that mutate, that set a value in the object, which is a setter. And in C-sharp, they have this convenient shorthand notation for a property, which is you just declare a data type, a name, and then if
yeah.
you open up this curly braces.
Where you have these methods for getting and setting values, instead of accessing directly the...
Yes.
So everything that's declared in there will automatically show in Bonsai.
Yes, everything that is declared in this way that is public, because you can also have private properties or internal, but all of the public ones will show up in the editor, unless actually we can even show this. So
I'll discuss
the possibilities later. But there's things you could do here that kind of control how the property shows up in the editor. And this will be quite useful and powerful later on. But let's keep it like this for now. But anyway, yes, anything you declare like this will show up in Bonsai as a property automatically, which is quite convenient because it spares you the trouble of kind of making your own interface.
Can we invoke a specific function every time we get or set one of these properties?
Yeah. So this is a shorthand notation saying I just want a value with the default getter and setter, which is just setting that value. But you can actually write functions. So you could write it explicitly like get return something, and the set do something. So you can for example, you could even say it's a bit unfair, but you could even say that this would be a fixed property that always returns zero, no matter, you can try to set it, it will always still give you zero. It's a bit useless, but to do it that way. But anyway, you can, yeah. In fact, that's the whole point of the properties, is that to allow you to override, to kind of get control over how you do the gets and the sets. Okay, so back to this. So these properties show up here, it says here properties. You will notice, and we will discuss how this shows up, that there's various little documentation strings that appear when you click on things, like there's a little description of the nodes, and even on the properties here below, kind of tells you a little bit of what the property is about. You can configure this also in the code, and I'll show you how to do it.
Sorry, can you rename a specific node?
Rename?
And imagine if you're working with Arduino, you buy 10 pins.
Yeah.
Maybe you want
Yeah. If you want to, you can do this. You can go. Let me hold this for a while because this is coupled to a more advanced thing. But you can do things like this. You can give names. You can create named data streams. Okay. That then you can reuse elsewhere in your program. But let's wait a little bit and we'll get there. A little bit there. Okay. So this is the basic, I guess, introduction. Is there anything else that I'm missing? Well, we'll see. I guess there's one thing that deserves mention is here on this little bar, that's not very prominent, but this represents the current working directory. This is just useful information to know. So if you change the value of this little text box, you will change the current working directory for the program. This means that if you have relative paths somewhere, they are relative to this path over here. This is if you ever program in MATLAB or in even in Python, you can set the current working directory. It's, yeah, this. Okay, so let's get back to the presentation and go back. There's many things to talk about. As I said, I didn't have a particular order. So now I want to explain the last basic bit of bonsai is branching. So the when you have you take a data stream, you can split it. And I want to give you the I guess for today, the only kind of more conceptual point I want to make about this is what branching means in bonsai. So this will be the conceptual point for today. It's the only one, but I think it's worth going through because it will give you a better understanding of what's going on. Okay. And for this, we go back to something we discussed very, very briefly yesterday, which was the concept of a hot and a cold observable. Okay? And the idea was that a cold observable kind of has its value stored, and whenever someone subscribes, it will replay or kind of, replay always the same value to the observer. Whereas the hot observable, you kind of just have one go. If you're not there when the value arrives, you lose it forever. Okay, like the camera, if you don't catch the image right away, you can't recover it 10 minutes later, right, by default. And I mentioned briefly that there were operators to kind of transform these a hot into a cold and a cold into a hot. Okay? And I just want to show them to you, because this is actually related to branching in bonsai, so it's important that you get a... We're trying to get like a really good conceptual grip on what's going on. So the first operator that I want to discuss is the replay, which turns a hot observable into a cold observer. And how does it do that? Well, replay takes as an input a sequence, any sequence, and it subscribes to the sequence, and it caches every single value that comes through. You can also give it a little limited buffer if you prefer. But by default, it will just store all the values, okay? And then what happens? Then if you have observers downstream that subscribe to replay, then if they subscribe in the beginning, then they see the same sequence, nothing happens. But then if someone subscribes later on, then as soon as they subscribe, they get a full replay, they get a dump of everything that happened that they missed, okay? So you see here, the second guy, the second line is another subscriber, and he subscribed over here, and immediately as he subscribed, he got all these values kind of broadcasted like in a immediately. So that's replay. Is it clear? Question?
So if you start a webcam and you start replay, does it just store
all the images? Yeah. Yeah, with corresponding memory increase, but yes, they will be stored.
And
you can limit. Yeah, I'll show you. You could limit the kind of how much you replay of the sequence. So that's any more questions clear? Okay. So the other observer, the other operator that does the opposite, in a sense, is publish. So publish turns any cold sequence into a cold observable into a hot observable. And how does it do that? So again, as replay, the operator subscribes to a sequence, any sequence. And specifically, it could be a cold sequence. So a sequence that... So you imagine that this sequence is cold. So if many people subscribe to this sequence, it will always get a replay from the beginning, right? And let's imagine that I did not want to do this, and I wanted to share just the values, so publish them. So again, if you subscribe from the beginning, nothing happens, okay? But what happens with publish is when you... So publish receives the values from the upstream sequence, okay, and does not store them. So it just shares them to all its subscribers. So because it loses that memory ability, then basically the values are dropped. So if a guy subscribes to publish later on, it will not see the first values. So it seems very simple, but there's a trick with publish that is important, but I will not go into it right now. But it's actually quite important, is how do you make sure... Actually, maybe I will go into it, because it's important to explain one thing about branching in bonsai. So one thing that is important is, how do you guarantee, okay, so this is all fine and good, that you want to drop values if someone subscribes at a later time. One point that is important is you may want a set of observers to at least these ones, you want them to start synchronized. So you want to make sure that they always see the same sequence of values. So later on, if someone subscribes, doesn't matter, they drop. But those, you want to guarantee that they see the same sequence. Okay? So how does this work? So it turns out that publish actually, it comes in a couple of variants. And one of the variants is you can control when the connection, you can control when the connection to the upstream observer happens. Okay? So actually you can imagine that you have publish, it's sitting there, it's not connected to anything, and then these guys subscribe to publish first, and nothing happens because it's not connected to anything. And then only after these guys connect, you connect publish to the initial guy, to the first guy. And this guarantees essentially that the initial observers all see the same sequence. Is this clear? Yeah. It's just to guarantee that they... So, okay. So how does this relate to branching in Bonsai? So when you branch in Bonsai, you are publishing by default. Okay? It's important to realize it's publish that is happening here. Why is this? It relates to what... Well, in a sense, it's a bit arbitrary whether you publish or replay or whether you don't do anything. We decided to publish because it felt quite naturally in terms of data stream processing that you want to publish in the sense that, for example, this is the example I typically give. So let's say I take a video stream and then I do some kind of color conversion and then I want to segment two different colors on this conversion. And the idea is that if this was not published, okay, then by default, this would generate two subscriptions to the file capture, okay? And actually, this is a bit of a technical point, but actually, if this was not published, then convert color would run twice on the same image. Because actually, these functions, so these functions, as we saw, the transforms, the white nodes are select, so they are collection operations, and they run once, they run on the incoming values, okay? And if you have two subscriptions, then the function will get called twice, because in a sense, each subscribe, whenever you call subscribe, you have like a little scope that is kind of like your own. So if you are doing twice, if this represented just subscribe once, subscribe twice, then you get two subscriptions through the convert color, and you'd get the function application twice. This may be important for, let's say, if you are doing things like integrations or some kind of nodes that have memory, they will have their own little scope, and it may be important to have to keep them separate. But the most common case, and we felt we wanted to give at least to people kind of like what we thought would be the natural kind of scenario that they will fall into, is that actually what you mean by this is you want to reuse the result of convert color, okay? So you don't want to run convert color twice in this case, you just want to apply the threshold, one threshold and another threshold, but on the same kind of result. So that's why we decided that Bonsai branches publish by default, okay? But you can override this behavior. That's what I wanted. So that's the default, so if you don't do anything, it publishes. But you can stop it from publishing by using replay. So you can just write replay. You can go here. So I have a camera. Maybe do some kind of threshold. Oops. By the way, you can also show you this, but you can. the syntax to create, or the there's a shortcut to create branches, which is Alt-Enter. But also another thing, when you right-click on the bonsai menus, it usually shows the shortcut keys to the right, so you can kind of learn by right-clicking how you kind of make your programming faster. So I'm going to create a branch. Okay, so this is publishing by default. And now here, you can write replay, okay? And replay will basically, if you replay, okay? Sorry, actually, this is a nested node. But if you replay now, yeah, let's go into nesting. This involves nesting, so let's go into this later. Yeah, I forgot this. It's kind of, but anyway, yeah, I don't want to add confusion at this point, but bear with me. But anyway, by default, the default branching behavior is publish. Okay, should be good. Sweet. Okay. So next thing, let's see what comes up in the next slide. Okay. Right, question, yeah, questions about this, like another breaking point. Let's check the time.
Do you have a dictionary somewhere?
A glossary, yeah. Probably I should put one. I'll put one in.
So just to read, so the two are publish
and replay. So all of the, so the, all the, all the names, yeah. Well, in a sense, the glossary for all the reactive operators are named exactly as in Rx. So if you go to the Rx website, and so I'll show you actually. So if you go to this is the web page I show I sent in the first emails. ReactiveX.io. So this is the reactive kind of website, and here in the top you have the documentation. And if you go to operators, okay, they have quite an extensive list of all the operators, okay? And the names in Bonsai are exactly the same. So and they will mean the same. They will mean the same things. So you can just come here and kind of go through the list and read about them. And they have explanations for what, for example, here on publish, you can kind of see kind of like the documentation of what publish means, and you can even have these marble diagrams that I was showing you. So it's the meaning is the same as this.
You should put them on the bonsai.
Yeah, but still, I'll put this on the bonsai website. It's quite useful to have. Okay. Another thing, I was kind of fiddling away with this, but it's actually interesting that let me try. I want to show you something just before we go. So another thing that about the editor before we move on, that I didn't talk about much, but is errors. Okay, just to, there's two kinds of errors. One is build errors. And these are kind of errors that happen due to program composition. So it means you connect two things that can't be connected. And this is because the data types are somehow incompatible, or you're missing arguments, things like this. And these errors, Bonsai will detect them, catch them, and it will show them to you by circling the affected nodes in red. Okay, so the problem is usually in that node. If it's a nested node, we'll see later, it can go inside the nested and kind of see where the problem is. And it also shows you here in the bottom a little message that kind of depends. Sometimes it's still not very useful or informative, but it will be the whatever message the programmer wrote when the error is detected. You can kind of, when you program your own nodes, you can write your own messages, and you can kind of decide what shows up here. These are build errors, You also have runtime errors. So when you when something goes wrong during the running process, and this is also an important point. So when if something goes wrong in the during running, okay. So for example, I'll show you one example. So this is already happened. So great. Yeah. So Sobel, I believe, only works for grayscale images. So it gave a runtime error because I was feeding it a color image, okay? And it's complaining that, it's some cryptic error message that actually comes from OpenCV. But anyway, what it's trying to tell you is that, actually in this case it's not that, it's actually that I needed to give a positive derivative. Yeah, now it's working. But anyway, so it does work on color. Anyway, when these errors happen, usually when these errors happen, you want them to happen. You want to be notified, you don't want the program to carry on in kind of a corrupt state. So so what Bonsai does by default is it will terminate the program and kind of show you a pop-up error message and again signal where the problem is. In this case, I ran it and the Sobel node became red and the message appeared. You can also, but it's only if you know what you're doing and it's kind of expected, you could also catch these exceptions and kind of, let's say for example that this error is not like this, but it's, for example, a connection error, like a network error. Someone pulled the cable and you actually want to retry again. You don't want the program to crash. You just want it to retry. So actually, this operator exists. You can do retry. Okay? So what retry will do is it will, on error, so when there's an error, it will connect to the observable again. Okay? And it will do so forever by default. Or you can use retry count and specify a number of the maximum number of times that it will retry.
Does it matter where?
No. The only thing that matters is that this specifies a retry to all the nodes before. So if I continue here, so if I put Sobel over here, now the retry does not apply to Sobel. It applies only to errors coming from the camera. So it catches errors upstream that are coming from left to right, and it resubscribes. But if something happens after, then it doesn't. We will go into this. I just wanted to show you that these nodes exist, but actually I'm getting ahead of myself because this probably should be better seen tomorrow. Sorry?
It does something else, like catch.
Yes, you can. Actually, it calls catch. It's called catch.
Okay.
So if you use catch, then you can specify. So the second data stream will be used if this one fails.
Okay.
All right. So let's continue.
That's new in
2.1, I think. 2.1 appeared. Okay. So but let's continue. We will see. The reactive operators deserve their own special attention, which will be tomorrow. So tomorrow we'll go in detail through most, not all, but maybe probably most of the lists that is on their website and see how they are exposed in Bonsai. But for now, I want to talk about another thing. I want to talk about data types in Bonsai. So if there's any questions, we'll do a break now. Now would be a good time to break. If you want to rest 5 minutes, it would be good. Okay, so we're at 5 minutes. Okay, I think we're all here again, so let's continue. So now I want to discuss another abstraction, or another set of abstractions that makes things in Bonsai kind of connect very smoothly. And this is, in a sense, it's independent of Rx. So Rx is just is the abstraction for how the data is propagated. Okay. But you also have to worry about data types, right? Because we have operations that understand certain data types, and if you don't have the right data type, then the operation will not be happy. So it pays off to kind of have also a common set of abstractions that is as unified as possible. In this case, one of the things that we were worried about from the beginning, because we were interested in using Bonsai for processing video and physiology data, multi-channel data, was to find an abstraction that would be kind of as broad as possible. And it turns out that multidimensional arrays, just the 2D arrays, are very useful for this. So they are broadly used in Bonsai. This now has nothing to do specifically with reactive, but it's more a decision we made to how this kind of data is represented in the packages, in the specific. So it's important to say that the core of the framework, so the way the language is structured, knows nothing about this. Okay, so this decision is now made at the level of the vision packages and DSP packages. They are the ones that kind of make the decision to use this. You could replace, in principle, you could make your own vision packages that you use another entirely different library. But anyway, what we have built in is image processing using the OpenCV. Okay, and OpenCV uses images. We are still in kind of an old legacy format using the IPL image. This will change in the future, hopefully this year, when we migrate to OpenCV 3. But for now, it's still the way we represent is using these IPL images. And this is just a 2D matrix of numbers, okay, as you see here. One detail that is important is we use these 2D matrices for two different purposes. So one is for images here, and the other is for multi-channel data. So this multi-channel data, very often, especially as you go to higher sampling rates, is buffered. So you don't get, and this is an important distinction to realize, is because we've been talking about streams of data, right? But now the granularity of the data that comes in can be something that is not immediately obvious where it should be. Because, for example, you could think you could have, let's say, an observable that is a stream of pixels, right? Of individual little pixels. But that's not how we want to represent it, right? We want to represent is a stream of images, where every image in itself is a buffer of pixels, okay? And the same happens for multi-channel data. So usually you don't want to process you don't want to acquire for latency reasons and for many other reasons. You don't want to acquire and process this data on a single sample, one at a time kind of basis. So what you get in Bonsai, when, for example, I'll show you an example with the microphone, you get buffers of samples. And then you can have many channels of this that are acquired synchronously. And this representation, kind of like this time series, can be represented also as a 2D matrix, okay, where rows are channels and the columns are samples. It's the convention. You can flip them one to the other. We have transpose operations and all of these common linear algebra and matrix manipulation operations are available in Bonsai. They work both. So all of these general operations that you can go over work as well for multi-channel data. Most of them work as well for multi-channel data and for images. Most of the reason why they are distinguished, one reason is for visualization purposes. So we have, if Bonsai sees a max data type, it knows it will represent it as this multi-channel kind of stacked time series representation. If it sees an IPL image, it will show you an image, okay? You can actually have operations to convert one to the other. And these actually cost nothing because it basically changes a header. So the actual buffer, the actual data storage is untouched. So you don't. So for example, I can show you what it means. So let's now put another data source and a microphone. Okay, and let's pick here. I have. Ooh, I don't even know which one. One is being used to record this talk. So, which one is it? Good question. Probably it's the Microsoft. Ah, it's this one. Okay, so here's some audio data. Okay. Yeah. So essentially. So this represents, so that this is acquired by default in buffers of 441 values to match the default sampling frequency. First, I'll start by showing, so this visualizer, the same as the images, has a bit of some tricks. So if you right-click, another one of these bars shows up, and you can do a bunch of little things. So again, you have the cursor, where you can see for the X value, which Y value is... are you pointing at? Another thing you can do is that by default, the scale of the plot is automatic. So it will you see that the bars are going all over the place as my amplitude speaking is changing. But you can set this. So if I basically unclick here the scale X auto or scale Y auto, then I can basically remove the auto scaling. And it just sets on a fixed. And then you can actually click, if you click on the numbers, you can actually set the specific values that you want.
Do you externalize the properties of the visualizer?
Not yet. This is an important point. Yeah. So visualizers are still one thing that we want to work on. I would say that for me, the least satisfying aspect of Bonsai right now is the visualizer API. That's why I don't talk much about it. There's still a bit to be improved. But that would be the goal, actually. That would be the goal, that visualizers would be unified as all the other nodes are. Right now, they exist in some kind of this other layer, which also uses reactive, so there's really no reason why they shouldn't be unified.
Is there a way to pre-save the default? Kind of.
Ah, but this is for making custom visualizations. Yeah. I think Pasha was just asking for saving these. So when you save the workflow, for example, if I now stop and I save the Bonsai workflow, there's always two files that are saved. So let's say if you're in an audio capture. So if I save it, one thing that when you save a workflow, it sets the current directory to the place where you saved it. And you can access that by clicking this little button. So if you click this little button over here, it opens the folder where the workflow is. And you can see, when you save a Bonsai workflow, two files get saved. A Bonsai file and a Bonsai.layout file. But this layout file saves information about the visualizers. So where they are, how big they are, and also the settings. And actually, if you go there, you can. These are all of these are just XML files. So you can actually just come here and you can specify by hand if you want the values.
But when I load the Bonsai workflow again, it doesn't load the calculation.
It should.
If you play again,
it should open. So now, if I play again, you see it resumed the.
Okay. Is it the way you trained it? That's the one.
It should be there since version 2 at least.
Okay. If you do any changes to the workflow, then it would always go wrong. I reset it to work.
Change the price of the window.
But anyway, what I wanted to show is, so this is a max, so it represents it like that. I'll show you a couple of things. One is, as I was saying, you can convert the matrix to an image. So you can say convert to image. So this treats the same buffer as an image. And it costs nothing, as I was saying. It's just switching the header. But now I have the buffer represented as an image. So now it's the same kind of data, but visualized as some kind of visual array. Okay. Then there's all kinds of operations you can ask me about, which ones you would like to know about. There's, I'll show you the tile just to simulate multi-channel data. So tile just takes this buffer and replicates it row or column wise as many times as you want. So this I'm just using it to create like a kind of an example multi-channel representation. By default, they're all superimposed because the waveform is exactly the same. If you want, you can add an offset here. So this is another thing of this visualizer, is if you, this little button, weird button over here, has two things you can do. So one is this visualizer actually has two faces. There's a kind of an overlapped mode. And if you click on this, you go to the grid layout. So you can kind of see the each individual channel independently. And actually, you can control in the overlapped view, you can control which channels are shown there by clicking on the numbers. Okay, so you can kind of, let's say I want it like this and this. Now when I go here, it's only showing me, I mean, now there's, again, they're the same, but it's showing me only the selected channels, okay? Another thing you can do is you can, if you click on this little arrow over here, and the more advanced properties show up, where you can kind of play with, do a couple of things. So you can play with time scales. So right now, this history length is a bit awkward because of, this visualizer doesn't know anything about the time scale of the process. So most of the parameters are set in buffers or samples, which can be not as convenient. We're working on how best to abstract this. But for now, this works, for example, in buffers. So in this case, I'm showing only one buffer. But I could say, for example, show 10 buffers. Okay. And now what Bonsai did is it's concatenating in the visualization the buffers in sequence. So you could say, OK, now give me 100 buffers. And now it's cycling through these buffers concatenated in time. Okay. Another thing you can do, display previews, it's to overlap the buffers, not concatenate them, but overlap them. This will be useful when we align events. If you want to kind of see overlapped waveforms, it can be useful. And you can also offset the channel. So in this case, they are the same. We can make them a bit different if we add a little offset. So now they're becoming different. Now they're zero. Okay, so you see, so now this channel offset just means make this value of an offset between each channel. So you can kind of artificially separate them. You can also say this channels per page basically means how many channels you have here. So by default, this is because it can become quite processing intensive to show everything at the same time. So you can, for example, I could replicate this to 128, for example. And now, by default, it's still only showing 16, and you can do page up, page down, and kind of go through the channels. If you want to show more, you can say, I want 42 channels per page, and then you can see the 42 channels per page, or however number. If you go too high, it may not be useful at some point, because it will be start being too expensive. But this, of course, depends on your processor and the specifics of the situation. Okay. That's so much about visualizers and matrices. So going back to where we were, the data types, the advantage of using the same data types that are already built into Bonsai is because you can kind of, you can use all of these features without having to recode them again. So if you make your own, let's say, image processing node, if you use an IPL image, then you don't need to code your own visualizer. It will already as soon as the bonsai sees that the output of your node is an image, it will know that it can associates the image visualizer to the node, right? If you do some kind of signal processing operation and the output is a mat, you automatically have all the features of this mat visualizer assigned to your node. So this is, in a way, if you stick to these common data types, then you gain a lot of things done for free, basically. So that's the advantage of kind of following this convention. Okay, questions about matrices and images? But, I mean, there's many operators we can go in detail if you feel like it. So if you want to explore at some point the toolbox, and if you want to ask me, I'm not going to go in detail for all of them, but if there's a particular one you'd like to know at some point, ask me. We're still working on the documentation and examples for all of this, but hopefully this will keep improving over time. Okay. Another feature of the editor. Editors. Okay. So you will notice, as you go through Bonsai, the property grid is relatively flexible, and actually you can... you will find that you can edit the values not just textually, but sometimes you can edit them graphically. So I'll show you an example. This is an example, actually. So I have here a crop polygon node that allows you to kind of specify a crop by defining a polygonal region, and then it will crop and mask the image to kind of just isolate that portion of the image. And then here you have a warp perspective, where you define a rectangular region, or actually just a quadrangular region, and this will define a perspective transformation that kind of puts that quadrangular region to fit all the corners of the image. It's kind of like that, to correct the perspective. Usually it's used like that. So how does this work? I just want to show you first, and then I'll show you how you define them. So if I do this, so camera, capture, warp, perspective, okay? You have all these different properties. And by default, the node is doing nothing. Oops, sorry, let me change the camera again. By default, the node is doing nothing. But let's say I wanted to isolate just the table and this little breadboard over here. So here in the source, you see that it appears this little button with the ellipses. If you click on the button, it opens another window. And here you can kind of define the region kind of online graphically, instead of having to kind of type the points. Instead of having to type the points by hand, you can kind of drag things around in a more intuitive way, okay? In this case, you define this, the region you want to isolate is this one, and it kind of maps it into the image, okay? So how did this work? Because clearly the property grid doesn't know how to write these automatically, so this is somewhere specified. And the way it's specified, the best way to see it is actually if you go to the... So actually it turns out... Bonsai is completely open source. So it turns out that a good way at this moment to learn the details of some specific node is to just go and look in the source code. It's not ideal, but it's right now... So if you go to the Bonsai website, you click on source, and the first thing you get is a list of all the packages, okay? And they have the same names as you see in the interface. You can just go, okay, let's go to Vision, somewhere here. And then you have all the modules, all the nodes in this package are listed with the same names. So if I go to Warp Perspective, which is the one we were looking at, wanted to know more about, you see... So this is the whole code, it's not that big, but you'll see a couple of things that are new. So first, in the properties here, you see that there's these little things placed above them, okay? This is what in C sharp is called, they're called attributes. So this is kind of metadata you can associate with your code. And there's this is used throughout C sharp and .NET to indicate various useful metadata, usually for visual editors and for user interfaces and or for documentation strings. It can be all kinds of things, actually. In this case, you see one that we use a lot is this description. So they're used like this. You put square brackets, and then there's a bunch of different attribute classes that you can use. One of them is description. If you add a description tag or an attribute, you can write a little string. And this string will be recognized by the Bonsai editor as the documentation string that should follow that node. So this little string over here is what specifies that when in the editor I click on Work Perspective, this little string that appears here is actually this one over here. Okay? So this makes it very general because Bonsai doesn't need to know what the documentation is. It's just that each node tells it what it is. And you can do this for each property as well. So you see each property also has a description, short description. And this appears here below the little window. Is again the string that is included here. Okay? But other things you can do to properties is you can specify editors. Okay, and editors are specified like this. So you say editor, and then the first argument is a type, is basically the type of the editor. So if you look in the Bonsai source for editor classes, it will show you all the ones that we have coded so far. But essentially what this is a class, so this is just the name of a class, that specifies how to edit that property. And there are many things you can do. You can open windows, you can show dropdowns. For example, I showed you in the threshold, you see this little slider up here, that you can kind of slide. That's also an editor. So there's all kinds of things you can do. You can control how the string appears. And for example, let's say you have a complex numerical value and you want to display it in a certain format. You can also control how the specific string is constructed in the editor by using editors, also converters. So that's how you can edit the editor in this way. Also, another advantage of doing it this way is you can reuse editors. Okay, so this class exists independently of this node. Okay, so for example, let's say you had some node to do something that was interesting to you, where it was also useful to pick. Regions like this. Okay, let's say you wanted to pick a triangular region for whatever reason, okay? Or let's say a crop. Let's say, for example, crop. In a crop, it's not a quadrangular region, but is a rectangular region. Okay, so now I'm gonna crop the image. So now let's say you wanted, and you can drag the little rectangle around. Let's say you had a node where you wanted to also specify a rectangular region in the same way as crop was, okay? Because crop is defined, because the editor for crop is defined in this way, okay? So let's put here crop here, okay? Because it's defined in this way, so it also has a rectangle editor, okay? You can simply, If you wanted, so this property needs to be of type rect, it's a rectangle, okay? But as long as you have a property that is of type rectangle, you can actually just copy this, for example, to your own. Let's copy this to our classes, for example, here. Let's say I put here the rect, okay? And now I need to, so this editor, this is the only annoying bit. To use this editor attribute, you need to add a reference to an assembly, to a library that where editor is defined. I'll show you which one it is. It's essentially system drawing. So this is all the system libraries. If you add system drawing, this is the only, okay. It just adds a reference to your project here, system drawing. And now you can use the editor, okay? And you will also need here this UI type editor. This is just something if you're not used to working with Visual Studio and C#, you will get used to as you practice. You have to add these little references and the usings. And then here on Rect, you need to use OpenCV. Okay, so now it's working. Let's say that my return value knows now the region of interest. And now the output of this is a Rect. And here is it. So now if I play, now I have my value source that we specified in the code, in our little project. But actually this one won't work because you don't have images. Actually, it will work, but it won't make any sense because you don't have an image to kind of overlay this on. Okay, that's an important point. So if I go here, you can still run it. But the problem is it will kind of show there's not even an image to show. Yeah. But let's make a transform from images to images, just so we can get the image. Observable of the image source. Oops. I'll just make this default. Select. Okay, so now it's a transform. I just want to show you this because I think it will be useful maybe later. So now if I add a camera and I add my little, well, that's a bit annoying because it's called a value source even though it's a transform. They changed it. But anyway, now I start playing this, I can define the crop region, whatever I want. It's not even a crop region, it's just a quadrangle kind of region. And now it's defined, it gets the values from the editor, and you can now use them. So that's the only reason why I wanted to show you this, because coding up these editors can be a bit tedious, or can take some time, because coding a user interface is usually laborious. But the fact that they are defined as independent editor modules that you can use means that if there's a particular editor in Bonsai that you like, and this can be anything from quadrangular regions to polygons to props, sometimes there's different pickers for, there's channel pickers, for example, a multi-channel matrix, there's a picker to pick a channel, things like this. So you can reuse them in your own modules. So you're just copying these editor strings, and it will be available. You don't need to code them up again. That's the only reason I wanted to point them out. Okay. Let me stop this. Oh, this probably. So that's the thing. Another thing that is nice about the editor is. The visualizers can actually be stacked, and this is also an important. I'm just listing all the useful features that are usually a bit hidden. But you can, so if you look at these different, this is a pipeline for processing in, like the canonical kind of pipeline for detecting objects. So you have some kind of filter, some kind of segmentation. You find the binary regions using some algorithm, and then you select which one is the region you want. Let's say it's the largest one, and then you pick some property. And then each one of these nodes has its own visualizer. Okay, so the up to here you have the original file, and then the image is transformed in various ways, and then you have, when you get to this binary region analysis, the visualizer already has no idea what the original image was, okay? Because it already has been processed through various filters and segmentation algorithms. So there's no way this guy can know what the original image was. So the only thing he can do is draw the detected objects in this kind of abstract way, okay? And the same for the centroid. When you get to this point, the centroid is really just a point of two numbers. So it means nothing. So the question is, how could you kind of bring this together? Because sometimes it's useful. We may want to put these visualizations in context of each other. Okay, and it's possible to do this for visualizers that support it. You can stack visualizations. Okay, so one thing you can do is you can, if you have a visualizer, let's say file capture, and you drag the binary region on top of the image. These visualizers are actually compatible for what we call a mashup. We call this mashup visualizers. So that they kind of mash with each other. And the image visualizer knows how to combine with this guy with other image visualizers in a stacked way. So this is basically just draw this on top of the image. Okay, and I'll show you in right now what we mean, but just to complete this. And another thing you can do is you can also...
There is no one.
There is a control backspace. But we will. So this works as a stack, so you keep stacking it, and you can also unstack using control backspace. But I'll show you this running in a moment. And you can stack multiple of these. So now I stack the binary region, and then you can stack the centroid, and it will draw a point, even with an optional trace, on top of the image. Okay. And I'll show you what I mean by this. You can... do it now. So let's again pick a camera. This camera is not running it anymore. It's good. So let's kind of follow these little objects around. So I'm going to do the same segmentation. So color convert. So this is just an easy way to do a color segmentation. Okay, so let's open this node. Saturation. Okay. Yeah. And then you can find the object. We'll go into what this is in a moment. Just to show you, I get the largest one. And I get the centroid. Okay. So now what happens? So now I can open up the different visualizations. Okay. So for example, when you segment all the objects, you see all the objects. On the largest, you only see the largest. Okay. On the centroid, you see the little numbers. Okay. But now what you can do is you can drag them on top. So this guy, you can drag this guy here, and it'll plot it on top. Okay, so you can drag the centroid on top of that, and then there's a little green dot, which will follow the thing around. If you want a trace, if you click again, left click, it will start drawing the trace. Okay, you can reset it again with a left click, and there's a little... And this could work, so for example, if you had... Let's say now I segment another color, okay? So I'm going to do exactly the same thing. You can also copy-paste nodes. This... another branch. Okay, so let's say I segmented two colors. So now I'm going to change this guy to be another ball that I have here. Another thing that is useful sometimes, you can get lost in many windows. You can select notes by clicking on the workflow, or if you click on the window, it will show up here the selected window. So these, when you click on a visualizer window, the properties change to be the properties of that window. So let's change this knowledge view to be the other guy. It's a bit more, the lighting is not so good, but yeah, hopefully it will be enough. Okay, so now we have our other objects. Okay. And you could also stack that on top. Okay, so now we have two objects kind of being followed. So there's no, it doesn't really matter how many visualizations you're stacking. You can also unstack them by control backspace. You pop them out. It's, okay. So this is still a bit experimental, and not all visualizers support it, but the image visualizers, which we thought were the most important to this, they support it, so that you can kind of stack them in this way. Okay?
Sorry, I'm not finding the central transfer.
There's no sense. So this, in a sense, this was obtained by right-clicking here and selecting the centroid. So just click on the centroid, and in a sense, this transform is generated. Okay. So there's no specific centroid transform. It's just automatically generated when you select the. Okay. So yeah.
I can follow what you have to do with the attributes in the code. I added the assembly for the
system drawing, and
system
then
drawing and what else?
And then if you hover the mouse on top of the word editor, it will show you a little light bulb, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And you can click on it, and you have to say using.
Okay.
You have to
for the description, it's not the, what is the assembly.
The description, you don't need the assembly for the description.
Oh,
so it's just a using. If you just go there, it should show you. Okay. Anyway, so before we go on, I want to show you one thing. We're running a bit behind, actually. We're already past our time. But I will say one thing. Here, since we have this workflow already set up, it's important to realize the transformations that are happening here. So up to this point, up to the threshold, you have all you have is images. Okay? They're being filtered and isolated in various ways. But then when you do fine contours, they become something else. So they stop being images. If you right-click, here, this is still an image. And now the fine contours gives you a contours. This basically happens because what this fine contours does is scan the image and detects contiguous patches of white pixels and discretizes that into a set of objects. Okay, it's like a sparsification of the image. So the data type is now the set of the contours that were found. And then what happens is now the image operations don't work anymore directly on this guy, because it's not an image. But some other operators do. For example, you can analyze these regions using the binary region analysis, and this will compute the moments, the most common moments of the most common image moments for each of the regions. Okay. One thing about this binary region, so one thing that happens in Bonsai that is not, maybe is not clear up to now, is that some nodes can take more than one type of input, okay? And I'm gonna show you. So let's say this binary region analysis, okay? If you give it a set of contours, it will compute the image moments of each contour. But if you just feed it the image directly, it will not complain, it can take an image, and it will still compute the image moments of the whole image. Okay, so now if I run it, it still works. But now you cannot see it because it's actually in. Maybe you can see, I don't know if it's hard, it's a bit hard to see, but the center of mass of the image and the axis are off center, so they're not centered on the object anymore. Now it's the center of mass of the entire pixel distribution, right? So binary region knows how to handle both input types. How does that work? So it works because of overloads in C sharp, and I'll show you what this is. This basically means the following. Let's say I had this transform, IPL image to IPL image, and I have here the definition. It takes an observable of images, okay? I could also declare multiple versions of this, okay? So I could declare a version for max, for example. You don't need the override for this. And this will be detected as you having several different options for the inputs, okay? And then if you feed it now a mat, this node still knows how to handle a mat. Okay? There's a long-running discussion in Bonsai as to the best way for graphically to describe which inputs a node takes. It's a very pressing concern that will be addressed in the mid-term. In the meantime, if you really are confused about the, inputs to a node, you can just go to the source code. It's not that inaccessible in the sense that it's always there. It's the same. For properties, you have here the output is here and the properties here and the and for these is also you have here. For properties, there's not a problem. The problem is only for the inputs to a node. It's not still very satisfactory. Yes.
So in the example you did in the transform, you receive image, or I mean, you can treat it as a mat.
Yeah.
But where does it transform from an image to a mat and then a mat to an image to output an image? Or it doesn't.
Well, in this case, there's no transformation, so it just selects which one to call. Okay? So if you give it an image, it will call this function. If you give it a mat, it will call this function. Okay? Actually, in this case, if you don't say anything, this would still work with mats, because mats can be converted automatically to images. Because of the thing. So this, if you just had it like this and you feed in a mat, it would still work. Okay? But for example, the output would be an image, even though you feed in a mat. But anyway. There's no if you have multiple overloads, it's just a selection process, which function is called. Okay. I had a topic here that I think I will skip in the interest of time, maybe even several topics. But maybe I'll mention it in brief. This is something we already discussed briefly, which was the fact that the visual programming language of Bonsai is actually a syntactic tree, so specifically is an expression tree that defines a program, an expression. And I don't have time right now to go into detail of the kind of powerful things you can do with this, but I'll give you one example to give you a flavor of what this enables. So you will realize that, for example, some of the file writers in Bonsai, some of the syncs that write your data to file, if you use them, I mean, you can use them casually, but you will notice that they are they can be surprisingly flexible. So, for example, if I put a CSV writer, okay, this writes data to a text file, okay, and this basically works with any input, okay. It's a bit weird why that would work, or how exactly would that work, because the code to write the data would be different in each case, because the way you format the writing and which means are written is different. And the way this works is actually that the CSV writer is taking advantage of the fact that there is this build process. And actually, when you put a CSV writer here, code is being generated to serialize, to write your data type to file. Okay, so this guy, when you hit play, in fact, actually, as soon as you put it here, it will analyze the input type that is coming in and generate code to write that type successfully to file. How does it generate that code? It basically goes through all the public properties and writes them to disk, and if they have nested properties themselves, it goes into the type, kind of unfolds, it flattens the whole data type into individual columns in a text file. Other nodes are similar. For example, you have like the OSC node. In this case, it's not compatible. I guess there's some more limitations, but if you do, for example, this scalar, this is compatible. So this guy is, for example, a sync that sends messages via an open sound control channel, the protocol I was mentioning briefly before. And it also does the same thing. So it creates kind of an interface to the network protocol automatically from the data type, such that you don't need to write the details of how the messages are organized in memory. We'll do that automatically for you. Other things that are interesting, for example, let's say I'm reading a string from a serial port. Okay, this is another source, as we are used to by now. It reads strings from a serial port you specify over here. But then you have a text, a bit of text. And for example, a common thing you might want to do is to parse the that text into something meaningful, okay? And the way parse works is you can specify a pattern over here that basically allows you to parse the basic data types. So for example, let's say I had like an integer and then another integer, okay? Something like that, separated by a comma or a semicolon or a dash dash, something like that, okay? So I specify this pattern, and what this node will do is for every pattern that is matched over here, it will generate the proper output type. So given this string over here, the parse node knows that the output must be 2 ints. Okay? And again, this is interesting because you're taking advantage of the build, basically taking advantage of the build tree, right, to make sense of this string. And so you can keep kind of, you can keep knowing which are your types, even though you have a node that seems like it is dynamic, but it's kind of so this is just to give you a flavor of the kinds of things that you can do. Unfortunately, yeah, we can discuss this later in another, maybe in the last day, if people are interested. Okay.
Can you write two sources to one file?
You can, but we will discuss. So this implies you are merging sources, right? So we didn't talk about the semantics for merging yet. Once they are merged, you can do whatever. So if you have two data sources, you merge them, then it becomes one data source, and you treat it as a normal one. But the tricky bit is how you fuse them. And this is
all what you want to do. Like,
yeah.
You want to do you want to first part of the file is one source, and then the second one is the other one, or you want to like mix channels.
Yeah.
Like,
merging different sources is a bit ambiguous, depending on what you want to do. You may want to concatenate the data streams, you may want to pairwise combine them, you may want to take only the latest samples from each, and so on. But we will go tomorrow. The whole day is dedicated to merging and playing around with just the data streams, so this will come up. Okay, this we've seen. Let's just quickly... Okay, one important thing, that this is a specific request that we have. There is something that is not immediately obvious. So you can run Bonsai in batch processing mode, okay? And why is this? Because you can call Bonsai from the command line, okay? So you can, this is another feature that is a bit undocumented, any others, but I'll show you. So basically, let's say I've opened a command line. command prompt. And, well, actually, the first challenge is to, let's create here a data flow. So let's say I have a file capture, and I do some kind of assemble the pixels, and I write into a file. So this will be my batch. Okay, so the first thing you can do, so the first annoying bit is where is Bonsai? So you have to call it from the command line, but you need to know where it is. And it turns out it's in this, by default, so Bonsai is a portable app, okay? What this means is that Bonsai is not does not need to register with the system to run. This has important implications, makes it very convenient in the following sense, that Bonsai is self-contained. Every dependency that you need to run the workflows and Bonsai itself is inside the Bonsai folder. This means you can just take the Bonsai folder and actually just copy-paste it to another computer, and it's installed. Okay? Now, by default in Windows, if an app is portable, then the data for that application and its installation should be stored in app data. That's the official recommendation. Okay, so every user, so you can also install a different version of Bonsai for each user in the computer. And unfortunately, this was a Microsoft decision. So for some reason, they made the app data folder hidden, which I guess can be understandable for some reasons, but I don't really understand it. But anyway, it's hidden. So there's two ways to access it. Is you either just write the name anyway, app data, and it will work, or you have to enable here these hidden files, hidden items, and then it will be shown here on your users. So if you go see users, your user, app data. Then if you go to local, there's the Bonsai installation folder. Okay, and then you can copy the path from the Bonsai executable. Okay, and so now I can call it from the command line. So it's just an application, right? So I can just run it. It will run like that. Yeah. But now what you can do is you can pass it arguments. And specifically, you can pass it. So if you pass it a workflow, so I'm going to pass it batch Bonsai. It starts Bonsai with the workflow already open. Okay. Now, more interestingly, there are some special semantics that you can do in combination with your workflow specification. One of the most interesting ones is if you externalize a property of this guy. So I'm going to pick the file capture, and I'm going to externalize the file name. Okay. So now it's an external property. If you do this, then this actually becomes, so I'm going to save, okay? This becomes accessible from the command line, okay? So now I can kind of call my Bonsai workflow and then say minus P, it's the flag, minus P colon, and then the name of the property, file name, equals movie.avi, okay? Enter. And now the externalized properties automatically filled in with that name from the command line, okay? And now if you want, you could simply, so you can do two things now. So now you could just run it. One thing you can do is you can automatically start the workflow from the command line. So if you say minus minus start, you run it, it'll start running. And of course, it didn't find the file, so it complained. But anyway, try. And if you want to run it in batch, sometimes you don't even need the editor. You just want to, I don't know, do something running overnight, and you don't really care about the editor, it's just some batch processing. So you can say minus minus no editor, and what this will mean, means just run the workflow, just the logic. So no editor, it can actually be even faster because you don't have any of the visual fanciness. So it just runs the thing until it stops. So now a couple of things. So for example, you see I ran it, and because there was an error, the error is printed out in the command line in the no editor mode. Okay. What is the semantics for when does this stop? So if this may not be, well, it may be a good idea if you, but if you run it with no editor, for example, on an infinite workflow, it will run forever, right? So how does it know when to stop? This you need to put a condition in the workflow itself. So you need to make sure somehow that your workflow will complete. Okay, there's a number of ways to do this. We'll discuss them tomorrow. But you could take something, for example, okay, take only the 100 images. And after this, it will complete. In this case, because it's a file, it will actually work just because a file will end eventually. So if it's a processing file, so you just need to do this. And it's, so that's how you run Bonsai from batch. So, so any language will be, from any languages will be possible to run things from batch. So you can just call this from your Python script or MATLAB script or whatever. You can kind of have Bonsai as your kind of batch processor for, let's say, like some kind of data intensive operation. You could use it. Okay, that's almost at the end, I think, for today. I'm going to push, I had a little bit of discussion on graphics, but let's keep this for the last day. I'm not going to discuss it today. I'm going to instead show you another thing that will continue tomorrow, but I think it's useful. So I'm just going to talk about the simplest version of nesting. Okay, how do you nest the most basic version? And tomorrow we discuss the more complicated one. So the basic version of nesting is the following. So let's say I had some kind of image processing operation pipeline. Let's say grayscale, just a background subtraction with some fine contours, blah, 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 the things I explained before. And let's say I wanted to kind of group this, instead of having this in a big pipeline, I just wanted to group these guys, okay? So if you just do Control G or select and then right-click group, there's many types of groups, as I was saying. The first one is the Control G is nested workflow. It just puts everything in this little node. It becomes also this golden color. You can give it a name. Say segmentation or something. And then if what happens? So this now becomes one node. You can access what's inside by double clicking. It will open the node, okay? And inside you have the following specifications. So you have a special source and a special sink that essentially indicate the inputs and outputs to the nested node. Okay, so whatever comes through here is whatever you plug in through here. Okay, and whatever is coming out through the workflow output is what's coming out of the node. The rules are you can have as many inputs as you want, but you can have only one output. That's the rule, the same as functions in a way. If you want to have multiple outputs, well, what you need to do is you need to combine them before using some operations, some logic you want, and then you send them out. You can actually leave things dangling like that, but this will just be ignored. This will not be sent, out as part of the output. So things that are interesting about this nested, okay? One thing that is interesting is you can as well externalize properties. So let's say I wanted to externalize the threshold value of the background subtraction, okay? If I externalize a property inside the nested, then if I access the nested, that property will appear as property of the nested, okay? So this helps a lot to define kind of your own mini nodes directly inside Bonsai. So if the operation you wanted to do is just a sequence of other operations, you can kind of group them, and by externalizing the properties, you can just start thinking just of that node. Okay. One problem that may happen is what happens if the operation somehow is the same, the property somehow is the same name. Okay, so let's threshold also has a threshold value. And now you see Bonsai complains. The name already exists, but you can change the name, right? So you can give it another threshold, and now the two thresholds appear. Even though these guys, so you can rename kind of the property. Another thing that you need to be aware, so I'm going a bit fast here, but you, all of these videos will be online. So the video from yesterday is already on YouTube, but I'll send you the link later. And this will all be online, so if you, something is not clear right now, you can see it later. Just finish this. So another thing you can do is, if you don't give a name, you can actually erase the name of the externalized property, okay? And it will still be there, but now it doesn't complain about the name anymore. And what this means is actually it ignores it above. So now this means you could be, for example, writing directly something here and you didn't want to expose it above. You can kind of control which ones are here. This also works for the command line. If you want to set nested externalized properties, you can actually just write minus p colon the name of the nested dot the name of the property equals well. So you can actually even access this nesting from the command line as well. Okay, another thing you can do with this once you have this nesting that is interesting is you can save portions of the workflow. Okay, so I'm going to show you one thing. So I'm going to save, if you right-click on a node, or actually on any collection of nodes, there's an option called Save Selection As. Okay, if you use this, and you save it, let's say, to the desktop, and I'm going to call it my segmentation bonsai. So now this is a special type of workflow. Actually, not special, it's just a workflow. But what you can do is you can... for example, if you are here on the Explorer, there should now be, hopefully, the segmentation here. So one thing you can do is you can drag this segmentation to the workflow. Okay. And now what you added is a copy of your little module. Okay. So now you can imagine having like a library of these modules, okay, that you can just keep in a folder somewhere, and then you can drag them in and kind of use them as your own utility functions, okay? Yet another thing, which is still not super obvious right now, is if you go to the Bonsai folder, okay, to the installation folder, because one thing you might be thinking now is, okay, but wouldn't it be great if these guys appeared also in the toolbox, okay, for me to kind of search as the other nodes. It turns out you can it's still a bit, it's a bit experimental, hence the why it's a bit hidden, but if you go to the Bonsai folder, there's a folder inside the Bonsai called Workflows, okay? There's a little readme even, that kind of explains that you can kind of build a user library of things. The way this works is it says here, in order to add workflow templates, create subfolders with category names that have Bonsai files inside them, okay? There's a little example. So if you do this, so let's say I'm gonna create here, this is my workflows, okay? And if I copy the segmentation inside here, okay? Now it shows up in the toolbox, okay?
I think if you upgrade Bonsai instead of installing it fresh, then the folder doesn't exist. So
yes,
you have to create
it. The folder and the little readme appeared in Bonsai 2.2. So the two follow there. But anyway, if you install the latest version, it will be there. And it's a bit annoying still, but you can do it. So you can put the the workflows there, and you'll have your own little toolbox of things. Okay.
Is everything appearing under workflow?
Actually, sorry. Maybe it wasn't clear. So under workflows.
Not only my workflows, but under workflows.
So this will repeat. So the way this works is if you see. Sorry, let me go back here. So if you see the way this is organized, so if you open a source, it has many packages. These are the name of the little libraries you have. Then inside you have the actual nodes. The workflows, the workflows toolbox works the same way. So the subfolders you create inside are your categories.
Okay?
And actually an important point is I can actually create, for example, I can create another subfolder. So let's say I have a vision, and let's say I'm going to copy this inside and call it vision. What will happen is it will not nest. It will create a myworkflows.vision. If you nest it uses the dot as a separator, just so you don't have like an infinite nesting of things. But you can kind of create your own. And all of these are searchable. So for example, if I search my workflows, it will show all of the things that are in my workflows. So this search, the search you put here, actually search for any part of the string anywhere in the designation of the node. So you can kind of find your workflows easily. Okay. I think we should stop here. Unless there are any questions about specific things. And then,
so to actually create a new one, you actually need Visual Studio, etc. To write. The only reason you need Visual Studio is if you actually want to modify the code.
If you want to write your own, well, in theory, you don't even need Visual Studio. Any C# compiler will do. So you, the only thing that for Bonsai, the only thing that matters is that there's a DLL. With code, with the proper kind of specifications.
If you can find a solution with Bonsai nodes, then you can make your own workflow and you don't need to use any Visual Studio. So as Bonsai grows and becomes Turing complete, you will need less and less Visual Studio.
Yeah, there's ideas for the future to make it more script friendly. So you could even just paste. You could imagine like putting a new node, and then you double click and opens an editor or a Visual Studio. You can just write. So, for example, you could do this. I didn't show. Maybe it's worth before we stop to show you the Python because it is interesting and useful. So, for example, if you write Python, a bunch of nodes appear. Okay, and for example, you can declare like say Python source okay, here, and if you open, there's an editor that appears. Okay, but you can write some code. So by default, it's a source that returns int. This is a kind of a idiosyncrasy because Python is an untyped language, but Bonsai is fully typed. So you can actually write any Python you want, but in the end, the function you need to declare this @returns, which is a decorator that basically tells Bonsai which is the type that is expected from the node. That's the only. But inside here, other than this only returns, everything else you don't need to do this. You can just write regular Python. Only on this function, you need to specify this. And then, for example, the Python source, you can use Python iterators to write the source. So, for example, you remember the iterator blocks from yesterday. Python also has them. It's not yield return, but it's called yield, just yield. So you could put like many values here, as yesterday. And you could even do, you can import libraries. So let's say I'm going to add some sleep in the middle of this. Okay. This is now just Python. So now this is this is compiled and then run. And you have your kind of a little Python source, okay?
You can import any Python libraries?
You can use any Python library that works with the, so okay, the conditions. There's limitations, yes. So the any pure Python package will work, first of all. So if you have a library that is just pure, pure Python, will work. The problem is, and this is the struggle with this, for example, NumPy works with limitations. The reason the limitations are there is because NumPy is actually not pure Python, so it actually has C, kind of a C native layer that for doing fast matrix operations, and this layer is not built in such a way that the .NET Python can use. Short, long story short, okay, and. There are ways, so some people tried to make to port this, and it was done 3 years ago, and then dropped. You can still kind of, if you want, if you're interested in this, email me, because there's a way to kind of hack it to make it work. In the end, I tend not to use it so much, because you can't really use everything. So you can use the basic NumPy, but for example, if you want like even more, let's say, even more advanced packages that are built on top of NumPy, then it becomes, you have to do this for every single, you'd have to do a proper port for every single one of these libraries. So it's not as useful, but yeah. You can call, one thing that is sometimes useful is you can also access any .NET library, you can also call from this Python. That's one thing that you can do. So for example, I can import, this, there's a tutorial on this on the website, but I'll write it over here. So you can, for example, my keyboard is right. You can import OpenCV, for example, which is a .NET library that Bonsai uses. And then you can kind of import its data types, all of them. And then, for example, you could create images. You have a source of images, for example, IPL image, size, V20 to 40, these things. There's a, this is, now it's just OpenCV syntax, that you could kind of, yeah. And now you have a source of images, okay? Same as before. This is garbage from memory. So it's just allocating the memory buffers. You can do, then you can do everything else. You can do Python syncs, Python transforms, and then there's others we didn't talk about yet, operations that you can write in Python. In the future, we plan to extend this to also support C# scripting. So you could just write a C# class directly in the workflow, and it could be treated as any other. This will make it take advantage of the Roslyn, so this is more recent developments. But there's a many ways in which you are thinking of extending this, but yeah, time is limited.
Is there a situation where it's better to use Python than C# or vice versa, or is it just based on personal preference?
Well, it's partially based on personal preference, convenience, and so on. So the one thing I like with the Python nodes is you can just carry them with the workflow, and you don't need to have a DLL to kind of need to. Of course, this is just because the C# scripting is not as well developed, because in the future this will all be kind of integrated in a way that even C# scripts or even the dependencies of the workflow will be kind of installed automatically. This is more like a workflow thing than the real but anyway, that's one argument. The other argument, so then in terms of efficiency, so the Iron Python, the .NET Python, is actually also compiled the same as C#. But there's still a runtime layer. There's still like a because Python is a dynamic language at heart, so there always has to be some kind of a runtime that's kind of doing the evaluation. So in principle, it would be a bit you would pay some cost of performance, but in practice, I don't think it really matters, because especially if you're doing these bulk operations over large buffers like images and so on. Where the cost really is in the bulk processing, which is handled by OpenCV anyway, in native code and using even optimized CPU routines. So in the end, I don't see, I use these Python sources all the time, and I haven't noticed any kind of performance concerns. So, But yeah, there you just have to be aware that there is this runtime kind of extra layer to run the Python, but it's really negligible given the rest of the process.
It's the Python node returns a list, the Python list, what will be.
Yeah, so Python list. So you can't return a Python list, but you can and cannot. Yeah, I'll show you. It's very easy actually. It's a good point. So let's say I wanted to. So you can't return a Python list. You have to return the .NET list, the C# list, which is the following. From system collections generic import lists. And then, for example, let's say it's a list of images. Okay? List of square brackets, list of image. You plot it like that. I think it's like this, you can see. Yeah. So now you have a list of images. Okay. And then inside how you create them, let's see if this actually works. But I believe you can just do... I'm curious if this should work. I believe it should be like that. I create mostly arrays and not lists sometimes, but that's right. And I think you can have to pass in here the list Python. I'll explain what this is. Let me just see if this works and then I'll explain. I'm curious. Yeah, it does work. Okay, so what's the reasoning? The reasoning is the following. You have, you import the list from system collections, the .NET list. You declare it's just a list of IPL images with the square brackets. And then you initialize it like this. You say list, square brackets, IPL image, and then you open curved brackets. I'm going to add some spaces here for clarity. You open curved brackets, and then inside you can pass a Python list. This is the part that converts kind of a Python list to a .NET list. And then you can return it. In fact, you can return anything. The problem is you lose the types in Bonsai. Actually, you can even remove this. If I remove the returns, it should still work. The problem is it becomes an object. It becomes a type that is unknown because it can be anything. Of course, you can also change. This also means you could change this completely. You could say I return a list once, and then I return numbers. This might make sense for your particular. Maybe have a list and then numbers. Okay? It's really dynamic Python, but if you want to keep it fully dynamic, then you lose the types here, and you have to kind of get them back somehow. But maybe with Python transform. You could imagine like having a some dynamic Python, and then at some point you do a recast, something like that. Okay. Anything else?
There must be a way to run Bonsai from inside Visual Studio.
Well, you do with the templates we saw yesterday.
Yeah.
You.
Let's say if I want to see directly all the numbers in Visual Studio.
Sorry, there.
So the code for the numbers.
Ah, for the built-in nodes. Yeah, you can. So it turns out all the source code. So this, this maybe is an important point. Maybe I'll keep this as because we're running out of time, I think. Way past our time. I'll show you before we end with all this how you do it. It's all of the source code for Bonsai is not only on the online repository, but is also on a special package server called a symbol server, where you can download debugger symbols, something called the PDBs, that you can kind of integrate them with. You can integrate that server with Visual Studio, and Visual Studio will know what the source for each thing is, and then you can do it.
And then you can
debug it. You can even debug inside the
whole.
Yeah. Actually, you can even debug the whole of .NET. Yeah. You can even go inside the code for list for everything. So everything of .NET is open source right now, so you can debug inside everything. So, but I'll show you this not now, or else we'll be here for a bit longer. But I can show you. Anything else? Cool. So thank you. See you tomorrow.
Thank you.